It's really good to see all of you. My message today is called A Crisis, Not of Faith, but A Crisis to Faith. It's revisiting Exodus chapter 14. You see here, I've got a nice poster of this movie that came out 10 years ago. For those of you who are movie buffs, you might recognize this title. 10 years ago, this movie called All Is Lost. What a very positive movie title, right? It was a very award-winning, critically acclaimed movie starring the great Robert Redford, which some of you may have heard of because he's quite a legend in the Hollywood circles. And it was a very special movie because it only consisted of 53 words in the entire script. And there was only one actor. And the story was just about how this man was sailing in the sea and his boat breaks down. And how he survives in the midst of such an overwhelming situation. He against the entire sea. How is he going to survive and be rescued? So I thought that that was an interesting picture because it's a good visual link to what we're going to talk about today. And the theme we're going to talk about is the idea of the crisis. The crisis, besides being circumstances which are overwhelming, is also a situation where victory is uncertain. We're not sure whether we will really make it through. So, just to give a bit of background about this Exodus chapter 14, which we are going to read, is that it is a incident, an event that happened in the Israelite history. The Israelites had been foreigners in Egypt and they had suffered terribly because they were pretty much slaves, and God wanted to bring them out from Egypt and settle them in their own land. So God sent Moses as his instrument to bring the Israelites out from Egypt. And so they had to travel in the desert. So when they were successfully led out of Egypt, finally, God led them along the way. And so God led them to this place by the sea, by the Red Sea, knowing God knew that the Egyptian army would trap them there. And so that's where there's the famous story of the parting of the Red Sea, which happened so that the Israelites could escape. That is objective number one. And objective number two is so that the Egyptian army would be destroyed as they chased the Israelites through the Red Sea, and then the waters came back crashing down on the Egyptian army. So not only did God give the Israelites a way out, He also thoroughly destroyed this great threat to their survival, so that the threat of the Egyptian army will no longer hang over their heads. So this is the account itself, which I'm going to take some excerpts of from chapter 14. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Tell the Israelites to turn back and encamp near Pi Hahiroth between Migdol and the sea. They are to encamp by the sea directly opposite Baal Zephon. Pharaoh will think the Israelites are wandering around the land in confusion, hemmed in by the desert, and I will harden Pharaoh's heart and he will pursue them. But I will gain glory for myself through Pharaoh and all his army, and the Egyptians will know that I am the Lord." So the Israelites did this. And then as Pharaoh approached, the Israelites looked up and there were the Egyptians marching after them. And they were terrified and they cried out to the Lord. They said to Moses, "Was it because there were no graves in Egypt that you brought us to the desert to die? What have you done to us by bringing us out of Egypt? Didn't we say to you in Egypt, 'Leave us alone, let us serve the Egyptians'? It would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the desert." But Moses answered the people, "Do not be afraid. Stand firm and you will see the deliverance that the Lord will bring you today. The Egyptians you see today, you will never see again. The Lord will fight for you. You need only to be still." Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and all that night the Lord drove the sea back with a strong east wind and turned it into dry land. The waters were divided, and the Israelites went through the sea on dry ground with a wall of water on their right and on their left. The Egyptians pursued them, and all the Pharaoh's horses and chariots and horsemen followed them into the sea. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand over the sea again, so that the waters may flow back over the Egyptians and their chariots and horsemen." Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and at daybreak, the sea went back to its place. The Egyptians were fleeing toward it, and the Lord swept them out into the sea. The water flowed back and covered the chariots and horsemen, the entire army of Pharaoh that had followed the Israelites into the sea. Not one of them survived. And that day, the Lord saved Israel from the hands of the Egyptians. And Israel saw the Egyptians lying dead on the shore. And when the Israelites saw the mighty hand of the Lord displayed against the Egyptians, the people feared the Lord and put their trust in Him and in Moses, His servant. And so, when I read this, or rather, there were some very wise commentators that saw that there was like a flow of events in this incident. The first thing that happened was that God spoke. God said, "I want you all to travel to this place, and that is the place where you are going to stay." And so Israel just follow lah. You know, since God say, God tell Moses, and Moses say, "Follow me." So they follow. And while they are there, the crisis emerge. The interesting thing about the crisis is that the crisis is like engineered by God. Because it was God who brought them, who wanted them to camp at that very spot. And God told Moses, "I know that the Egyptians are going to come. In fact, I want them to come." So that's why I say that this crisis that Israel faced at that time was engineered by God. We may even go as far as to say that God led them into this crisis. And when this crisis emerged, they were afraid, they cried out, and God used the opportunity to carry out the miracle of the parting of the Red Sea. And as the miracle happened, and they were rescued at the end, when they went through the entire thing, at the end, when they finally reached the other side of the Red Sea, they looked back and they said, "Wow, we can really trust God." And so their trust in God increased. Now, why is this incident in the history of Israel so important and so relevant to us Christians today? Because I believe that this is a pattern that is repeated in the Bible. Now, if we consider, for example, we have explored the life of Abraham before. And when God told Abraham, "I'm going to make you the father of nations. I'm going to make sure you have a lot of descendants, basically. I'm going to give you a great land for you and your descendants to possess." Who was Abraham and what did he have? He was one man with one family. And worse, his wife cannot give birth. The wife was childless for many, many years already. So there was a crisis. What should we do? How are we going to become the father of many nations? We're not even able to give birth to one child. And then God worked the miracle. Isaac was born. And that's when Abraham realized that, hey, I really can trust God. God can make the impossible possible. And if you consider Abraham's descendant, his grandson, Jacob, when Jacob was running away from Esau, and when he went back to his homeland, right, and then he received word that his brother was coming to meet him. And there was a problem because he thought that the brother was going to seek revenge for what he had done to his brother. Who was the one that, why did Jacob go back home and so meet his brother? It was God that told Jacob, I want you to go back home. So it's God that lead him right into the path of his brother, so to speak. And then God had to make the miracle of the brother forgiving Jacob. And then Jacob realized, hey, really can trust God. Or if, what about Jacob's son, Joseph? What must Joseph have felt when he told Potiphar's wife, I'm not going to sin against God, and in his desire to honor God. And then he was put in jail. And then he went through so many years of imprisonment. What must he have thought? The crisis, like, huh? What my brother, what all this going to bow down to me? I'm going to be a great man. You mean me a great man in prison? The crisis, then the miracle, and then the trust in God. If you consider Moses himself, what do you think it was like for Moses when he was tasked by God to bring Israel out from Egypt? He told God straight up, I can't do it. And then when he went to the Pharaoh, he and what army going to tell the Pharaoh, let my people go? But yet God did the miracle. And then Moses was able to trust God. What about Gideon and the 300? What about Elijah? What about Nehemiah? What about the other apostles? What about so many of the other people that we read about in the Bible? We will frequently see God speaks, God leads. They say, okay, we will follow. And God leads them right into a crisis. And then God does a miracle. And then they come out at the end saying, I can really trust God. You see, if this is the pattern in the Bible and not just a once-off, then we can probably conclude that this is the character of God. This is one of God's favorite ways of working. This is how God commonly works in the people who follow Him, which means that for us today, there is a great likelihood that we will go through the same process at certain points in our life. At certain points in our life, God may speak to us and God may challenge us to do something or prompt us to do something. For example, God may challenge us to leave our jobs, to leave a secure job. God may challenge us to give a sum of money or to give up a certain piece of property. Or like Uncle Chonga has been sharing for the past couple of sermons, that God challenged him to forgive the people who hurt him. Some people, for them, just being willing to live until the next day and not succumb to hopelessness, that's the challenge that God issues to them. For some people, God may challenge us, you need to speak to someone. Say what? Don't know. How to say? Don't know. When to say? Not sure. But I just want you to go and speak to this specific person. For some people, coming to church is the challenge. I've shared before about the person that I met. He cannot come to church because he needed to work. He was so afraid that he will go hungry that he don't dare to even set aside time for God on Saturday or Sunday or even for any kind of cell group. So the challenge and the prompting is a very personal, specific one. is very different for different people. For some of the young people who are here, the challenge can just be to study. The challenge can just be to not join that group of friends. The challenge can just be, whether it's for the teenagers or for some of the older adults here, wait for your life partner. Don't kanchong. For some, it's the other way around. This is not the right one. You got to separate. And there are so many things that God can tell us to do. And when God tells us to do something, we always have a choice. Obey or ignore. Say, yes, God, I will do it. Or pretend that we didn't hear God. Pretend is only our imagination. Whatever it is, when we ignore God speaking to us, then the whole process stops. There is no next stage. There is no continuation of the process until the next time that God speaks to you again. But should we choose to obey? At first, it may seem easy. Like if God gives you a dream and tells you to quit your job, at first, let me say, okay, Ken, I've been looking for a change of job environment anyway. Sounds good. Okay, let's do it. It sounds easy, right? Until the week you're going to quit, then you realize, hey, oh no, I only have so much in my bank account. What am I going to do? Then the panic sets in. Then the insecurity sets in. Then that's when you have what I call a crisis of belief. This crisis of belief, this crisis, right, I want to define it properly tonight. This crisis, it refers to the kind of problem that we face when we obey God's specific and personal instruction to us. This crisis is not referring to the crisis of our own making. That means we dig the hole and then we jump into it. There is a crisis of our own making. For example, if today I choose to cheat on my wife, that is a crisis of my own making. That's not God leading me into that situation. That is my choice. So there are many situations in our life where we create problems due to our own weaknesses. But today we're not talking about that. That deserves a separate discussion of its own. Today we just want to focus on the crisis that emerges as a result of following God's specific and clear instruction. Not like when we go and challenge God, or not like when we tell God, I need this, do this for me, or whatever it is. It's not like I don't like my job and I decide on my own, well, God wants me to be happy, right? You know, God's priority is my happiness. So what I'm going to do is that I'm going to quit my job. Because you know the Bible says in Matthew chapter 6, God is going to provide for me when I quit my job. So I don't like my job, I'm going to quit and God is going to provide for me. That is called a crisis of your own making. And so when you panic and when you feel stressed, that is because you put yourself there. So that's not what we're talking about tonight. What we're talking about tonight is when you hear from God. Whatever it is. And then you come to that situation. Why is it a crisis? You see, a crisis is when, firstly, a situation emerges and we look at the situation. We look at the problem and we realize, hey, this problem's serious, you know. This problem is going to cause a great impact, you know. What my business like this? What my income like this? What my children like this? How? So, for example, when we needed to talk to my mom before we got married, me and Stella, my mom told me, no need to have wedding banquet. Just get married and you all just go on a honeymoon because she didn't like Stella. And so I didn't know what to do about it, right? But one day, God spoke. Stella just had a prompting. Said, Danny, I need to go and speak to your mom. Huh? Why? Because I think God wants me to. Huh? Then how? Say what? I don't know. Talk when? I don't know. Then what I need to do? Nothing. Don't know. We just know that God wants Stella to speak to my mom. Oh, yo, I am more stressed than my mom, I tell you this one. And so, right, when I said, I can't even remember whether or not I told my mom that Stella was coming. I may have, I may not have. I may not have told my mother so that my mother cannot escape. But whatever it is, right, I remember it was that night, that evening, when Stella came over to my house. I remember exactly where we were sitting in the living room. And then Stella was there, I was here, my mom was there, and in my heart I thought, what's going to happen now? Crisis of belief. Because I look at the problem and I think, you mean God wants you to change my mom's mind about you? Really? It's impossible. Because it's so difficult to change my mother's mind. When I try to change my mother's mind, the natural result is that we end up in an argument. She switch off and I switch off. I've given up for so many years. And so the problem seems so huge. And then, the second thing we look at in a crisis is that we look at our own resources. We look at our hands. We look at our abilities and we think, the problem's so big. My resources so small. I cannot talk. My wife, I don't think she has the gift of the gab so much that she can just magically change my mother's mind. How? Our resources are inadequate. Woefully inadequate. Absolutely not enough for the situation, for the problem. And then, lastly, in the crisis, we look at God and we ask, God, can you really do it or not? Your name, right? Your name is power. Really or not? In that moment, I really have to ask myself, Jesus, got power or not? Don't know whether I got power or not. Can God really do it? Is God really strong enough? Will He really do what He has said? We hear about it, we read about it, but can He really? So we look at these three things: the problem, our resources, and we look at God, we realize we're not sure. That's when panic comes in, stress comes in, anxiety comes in. And that is why it's a crisis of belief. Because this kind of crisis, right, if you were to put it really plainly, really summarize it, it comes down to, do we trust God to be greater than our circumstances? If the answer is yes, there will not be stress. If the answer is no, or not sure, there will be stress. The stress and the anxiety are a clear signal that the belief in God is not enough for that situation. And that is why it is called a crisis of belief. Do we really believe God? In such situations, the fear is real. The worry is real. And this is when the rubber meets the road. Why does God make us go through such a crisis of belief? Why put this kind of roadblock for us? Why not just speak, we obey, make it simple for us, and then happily ever after? Then life becomes simple, right? Why does God want us to go through this crisis of belief? You see, the crisis from God is to let God see our quality, right? Is to let God test whether or not we are ready, right? Like, I'm going to bless this fella. But let me see whether or not this fella is worthy of my blessing. So I'm just going to see, hey, can you pass my test? Do you have enough faith in me or not? Oh, not enough. Oh, okay. This one, not enough faith. Oh, too bad. Cannot. It's a test for God to see our character and our quality, correct? It's a, to test us. Correct or not? Absolutely not. I don't think so. I don't believe so. You know why? For example, right, if you were to look at Peter the apostle, right? So Peter denied Jesus 3 times, right? We all know this. Did Jesus know that Peter is going to deny him 3 times? Yes, whoa. Jesus told Peter clearly, it's Peter that don't believe. Jesus said, no, I will never do this, Jesus. Everybody leave you. I alone will stand by you. But Jesus said, no. You are going to deny me 3 times. And it really happened. So God is perfectly capable of seeing how we will react in a crisis. He knows. Right, it's like simple maths, right? If God is all-knowing and all-powerful, but yet we say He does not know how we're going to react. Hey, something is wrong a little bit. The maths doesn't seem to add up. So God knows. So some people, right, they have this concept that when we go through tough times as a result of following God, that's God testing us. That's God testing our faith, whether we have enough faith or not. I think that the Bible shows us that God knows just how much faith we have. And if that's true, right, it cannot be that God is trying to test, God is trying to use that crisis, right, for Him to see. No, it's likely not for Him to see, but it's for us to see just how much or how little we really trust in God. You know, last year, right, when I was having cell group with my teenagers, you know, I asked them, I said, how many of you think that you love God a lot? During my time, if someone were to ask me this, ask myself this, when I'm a teenager, nobody would dare to put up their hand. Nobody would dare to say, I love God a lot. We start to think, oh, I sin in this area. Oh, I do this. Ayo, doing praise and worship, I look at my phone. Ayo, read Bible, I sleeping. Ayo, how to say I love God? Cannot. The teenagers in my cell group, last year they said, all put up their hand, said, yeah, we love God a lot. I said, oh, really? And they really believe they love God a lot. How will they know? How will any of us know whether or not they really love God a lot? It's when God puts them through that ringer, that crisis. And then they will see. And indeed, many of those teenagers that say that they love God a lot, soon after, never come church. Why? I got homework. Oh, I got this. Oh, I got that. All not free to come church already. All not free to do the things that they said they would. So they thought. Many times we think, but God wants to show us that we may not have as much faith in God. We may not know God as deeply as we think we do. But that is why we go through that crisis. Yes, this is really my main point tonight. The purpose of the crisis that God deliberately puts in our path is not to test our faith as much as it is to build our faith. Because you see, if you go back to the example of the Israelites, in front of the Red Sea. When did the Israelites fear the Lord and put their trust in Him? Was it before they went through the Red Sea, or was it after they went through the Red Sea? No, the Bible shows us that before they went through the Red Sea, they were full of fear and they accused Moses, "Why you bring us out to die? Who is Moses, the instrument of God, the prophet of God, the one sent by God?" So when you accuse Moses of bringing out to die, who are you actually accusing? You are accusing God of bringing out to die. Maybe you just don't have the courage to say that to God. And indeed, many, many chapters later, this is what God told Moses. He said, "Moses, don't be afraid, because when they scold you, right, actually they're scolding me, you know. So I'm going to settle it for you." And so, right, at that moment, when they're so full of fear, what is the reaction? Did God say, "You mean you don't believe that I'm going to part the Red Sea? Then I won't part for you already, lah. Forget it. Because you never have the faith, ma. You don't have the faith that I can save you. What for I save you?" No. God didn't say that. God didn't let their lack of faith stop Him from bringing them through that crisis or to do that miracle. Why is that so? Because the purpose of the miracle is to build the faith. God wants them to walk through the Red Sea in their fear and in their worry, so that when they emerge at the other end, the fear and the worry will be gone. And that is why the Israelites fear the Lord. And this is a good fear. This is not the scared God. This is the fear and honor and respect when they realize that God really is God. Oh, God is not just a concept. God is not a tradition. God is not just some idea that we have. But God is real. And they put their trust in God after they go through the Red Sea. And so, when we are going through, when we are following God, when we face difficulty, when we're discouraged, when we're afraid, as a result of following God, I must emphasize again, as a result of following God, then we must keep in mind that we should not be condemned. We should not feel condemned, and neither should we condemn others. Because it is God's intention that, see, what did God say at the beginning? Through this, I will gain glory for myself, and the Israelites will see. It was God's intention from the beginning. Just as how it is God's intention for us in the beginning, when we go through a crisis, that through this, my son or my daughter will come to know who I really am. Deeper and deeper. But that also means that if we say that we are following God, and when we meet with problem, because we do follow God, it is not judgment from God. It is not disapproval from God. It doesn't mean that God is punishing you for your sin. God is displeased with you. No. Because God is putting you in a situation where He can walk with you. And that also means that when we tell God that, "God, I want to follow you. I want to do what you say," then we must be prepared for the crisis. We will feel scared. But it's okay. We cannot let that fear stop us. You see, because when did the Israelites realize that they can put their trust in God? Right at the end of that process, after that, when that crisis emerges, we have two choices. continue or give up. Just like today, when I come out to full time, when we have money problem, we have two choices. Continue and see what happens at the end, or quit and go back to Singapore. The high exchange rate makes it so easy for me to see that I have two choices. Because I can take up any job in Singapore and I will earn enough for my family. I can be a bus driver and I can earn what? 3,000 Sing dollars with OT? 3,000 Sing dollars. What is that in ringgit today? How much does a working, how much does a PMET earn in JB today? I can be a cleaner and be paid 1,000 Sing dollars and come back, I got 3,000 ringgit to spend. There are so many jobs that I can just quit and just go and do if I give up. But if I give up and I go to Singapore, then how will I see that God really can provide? But you see, I have to clarify over and over again, there's nothing wrong with working in Singapore. For me, it's a personal choice that emerges from a personal prompting to stay here. God does not want everybody to work in JB. That's not so. God has a different instruction, a different prompting for different people. But there's an example that I use. If we give up along the way, if I go to Singapore and work, can I still come to church? Can. Can I still serve God? Can. Can I still work? Can. Will God still love me? Yes. But what happens in the end is that, hey, I never get to trust God. So when what we sing on the screen about the name of Jesus being powerful, about trusting God, all these, they just remain as words for me. They are just a theory. They are not, when I sing, I'm not singing from my life. I'm not singing from real experiences that, yes, God, this has been true in my life. So I sing with conviction and confidence, knowing that God really has done it. So if we want to have that kind of experience of God, if we really want to have that kind of Christian walk with God, that's not just like just a religion, right? We have to be willing to follow God, even if into the crisis. Because when we're in the crisis and we're continuing obeying, then only we will experience God. So when Stella was talking to my mom at that moment, the crisis, did God really come true? God, you asked us to be here. You really can handle the situation or not? Or you only call us to be here and then we're left our own devices and then it's like very, very humiliating, very ugly situation. What if my mom chased out Stella? Then how? Hey, get out, get out. I don't need my house. Then, how to put back the, I don't know what to do. But at that moment, the first word, one of the first words that come out from Stella is that, Auntie, do you know that our families are very related? I think my mom's been thinking, who wants to be related to your family? And I'm like, what is she talking about? Because we didn't discuss prior to this what we're going to talk about. No, Stella just was sure. He said, I just think that God wants me to tell your mom to reassure her that I'm not going to snatch her son away. That's the main point she wants to hit. But the introduction, Auntie, do you know our families are related? This we did not discuss. I think it must just come to my wife then. And that was such a miracle. It was that phrase that turned my mom's demeanor, her old attitude around. The first change, she was intrigued. Huh? What do you mean? Then Stella said, Auntie, when your mom attend FGC last time and go to cell group, it was my parents who fetch your mother to cell group every week because they're in the same cell group. And they used to tell me about your mother. She was like this, like this, like this. Then my mother, she was so amazed. She said, oh yeah, somebody always sent my mother to cell group last time. Oh, it's your parents. And that was when the ice was broken. And by the end of that short 1 hour conversation, there was a great 180 degree change in the attitude towards my wife. That was before we were married. How? How can it happen? Did we know that God was going to do this? No. Did we know that God arranged this at the beginning? Well, we didn't realize it. Have we heard before that God can help us? Yes, here before. Have it been preached on stage before? Yes, preached on stage before. We got sing before? Yes, sing before. Read before. But in that moment, to really experience it is a whole different thing. And that day, we experienced it. And it gave us so much confidence that what God say, He will do. And when God brings us to that, He will also bring us through. And give us so much confidence that in that crisis, we don't know how, but God knows how. It teaches us that we may be afraid, but our fear cannot stop God from working. Our fear will not turn God off. As long as when we are in that crisis, we make that choice to obey. See, were we scared? Yes. Do we have faith that God will really pull through? No, because if we did, the fear won't be there. What we did have faith enough, though, was to just show up for that meeting. So we had some measure of faith. Add on a lot of fear. With that measure of faith, that small measure, we chose to continue to obey God. So it can be with all of us this year. As we feel fear, anxiety, stress in a crisis that God leads us into, still we can choose. Still, all is not lost. And we can choose to say, God, I don't have fear to run the next 10 steps, but I think I can dare to step forward that next one step. After that, the next 10 steps, I don't know how, but that one step, I do for you. And as we take that one step, God will show us how to walk the rest of the 9 steps. He may even carry us for the rest of the 9 steps. But we will never experience God if we just stop at the crisis and we give up. But lastly, I just feel like I need to reassure many of the brothers and sisters who are here, that God knows what we can handle and what we cannot. Yes, there may be crisis, and God lives in crisis, but Christian life is also, for most of us, not crisis after crisis after crisis after crisis. God's intention is not for us to live in a perpetual state of fear and worry. But as we follow God, and if He does bring us into a crisis of belief, He knows how much we can handle. Different people can handle to different levels, and God will customize for us. All our journeys with God are bespoke. I never learned this word until a few years ago when I was shopping for my wedding ring. Then I realized, why is this bespoke? You mean what? Speak beforehand? No. Bespoke means like the jewelry, right? It's like specially designed and customized just for you according to your specification. There's no other one like it. And so it is with our journey with God. And so it is for the crisis that God leads us into. They are unique to us, and God will provide for us uniquely. God knows how much we can handle and how much we cannot handle. But as we must persist in obeying God if we want to experience Him. Shall we pray as we end tonight's message? Jesus, we thank You because we know that Your heart for us is always love. Your intention for us is always loving. Everything You do for us is part of Your wonderful, special plan for each of us. And Your plan is not to harm us, but to prosper us and to bless us. And that even as You bring us into certain crises in our life as we follow You, that it is so that You can bless us. It is so that we will prosper. But God, we also confess that there are so many times our faith is not enough. Our trust is not enough in You. But God, we know that You love us so much. You will always be with us every step of the way. That You will comfort us. You will reassure us. You will encourage us. And that You will bring us through so that we can know You deeper. For the Bible says that this is eternal life, that we may know Jesus. Thank You, Jesus, that all our journeys with You are so special and unique to us. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.